joined ISRO soon after his post-graduation from IIT Bombay in the year 1973, and therefore he has been actively involved in all the major projects of ISRO. His specialization has been in the flight dynamics mission and developing the IT infrastructures, which means the software as well as the hardware components. So he has been involved in the missions like IRS, GSAT, INSAT, CartoSat, ResourceSat, OceanSat, class of satellites, Chandrayaan 1, and even the recent Mars Orbiter mission. So he has developed the total infrastructure, IT infrastructure of the ISRO and the data center also of ISRO. And he has been responsible for the deployment of remote sensing data reception and processing systems at various data reception centers in India as well as abroad. He has been in touch with or in consulting the space agencies from Germany, Russia, South Korea, Canada, Thailand, Italy, France, Canada, and so many countries. And he has represented ISRO in several national and international committees. He has over 25 publications in the fields of satellite mission operation control and IT infrastructures for any such establishments. He has been conferred ISRO Merit Award and the coveted Performance Excellence Award. He has an interesting hobby, which is spreading awareness about space technology among the students. We have been very happy to have him here because he is addressing the youth, basically. He has delivered more than 50 lectures in various schools, colleges, IITs, and NITs across the country. So we look forward to a very interesting lecture.
I will cover basically some basic aspects of orbit, how a satellite is put into the orbit, what makes the satellite to go into the orbit, and then I will cover about for different purposes of satellites, we need to put in different orbits. What are those orbits? How do we put it, put there? Sometimes we need to adjust the orbits. Because of various factors, the orbit changes. Orbit, even if you put it in an orbit, within no time, the orbit will be different. So we have to correct the orbit so that we keep it in the same path so that we can use it for the purpose for which we launched it. A typical view of what all kinds of orbits are possible around Earth, this is not total. In fact, I could not draw all the orbits. So all kinds of orbits are possible. You would be wondering why these kind of orbits. During the course of my talk, it will become clear why we need different orbits for different satellites. There is a overview of telling what kind of orbits are there for what kind of applications. I will go more into detail later. Typically, 1,000 kilometers, 20,000 kilometers height orbits are used for Earth imaging. We call it as remote sensing. It's not just Earth imaging. It's identifying or getting information about Earth, not only the surface of Earth, up to certain depth, certain information about Earth through a technology called remote sensing. Okay. So that is, we call it as imaging in the sense, imaging when you say it is in the visible spectrum. But we do this imaging even beyond the visible spectrum, infrared, ultraviolet, then microwaves, like that we do this imaging through those this thing. Then communications, navigation, astronomy, experiments. Around 20,000 and above are used for navigation, communication, then the astronomy, and there are something called halo orbits. I'll come to that later. Near Earth, very, very near to Earth, certain orbits are there. They are used for basically for the strategic applications, for defense satellites, and our space shuttle also is in a very, very low orbit. And here also, there are some satellites which are used for Earth imaging. If you want a high resolution imagery, you have to be as near to Earth as possible. Then there are orbits called hyperbolic orbits, which are not elliptical. They are like a part of the hyperbola. These are used for interplanetary trajectories. What makes a satellite go around Earth in an orbit? Generally, people ask me when I go to some schools, they say, it is because of gravitational force. If I ask students, they say it's because of gravitational force. But next moment, the student himself has a question that if it is gravitational force, the satellite should have fallen. What is this? So there must be gravitational force is one force, which is there. So we create another force in the opposite direction, in simple terms. Okay. Or this is explained in a much simpler term like this. This is called a Newton's mountain problem. Okay, you throw a stone from somewhere. You throw a stone with some force, it goes and takes a trajectory and falls somewhere. And then you throw it with higher force, it goes much higher up and falls at a further distance. You become Hanuman. You give such a force to that object so that you throw it in such a way that it is continuously falling. This outside circle, the object is continuously falling. It is falling because of the gravitational force, but you have given a velocity to it in such a way, or an acceleration, I would say, such a way that it creates a force in the opposite direction. It can also be explained in terms of centripetal and centrifugal force. Okay, so this is the simplest term. In fact, we don't treat this in this way, but for common man, we tell it this way. It is also told, that is why it is also told, satellite is a continuously falling body. Okay, so what makes a satellite go into the orbit is, you take it to the height at which you need to put in the orbit, and then impart a velocity to that. Okay, that is what. This imparting this velocity at a height, taking it to that height, imparting the velocity is the job of the rocket. Okay, you saw the rocket launch. Some of you might have seen the rocket launch outside. It went up. After some time, what happened? The rocket went that way and then fell on the tree. Okay, why it went that way? It went that way because of the bend it took by the Earth gravitational force. Okay, so we have to put it in such a way that the gravitational force cannot pull it down totally. It has to balance so that you put it in the orbit. This is the simplest way one can tell how a satellite gets into the orbit. Johannes Kepler, he is the first one in the modern science, modern astronomy, who told that about the motion of satellites or planets around sun. Same thing applies, the motion of satellites around Earth, okay? Or any satellite around any planet. He is the one who told that orbits are ellipses. It is an ellipse with sun at the focus, one focus. Any ellipse have got two focus, sun at one of the focus. This is what he told. Every one of the objects moving in the space are following this particular track if it is a closed orbit. Second one he told. It says very clearly, second law says, when the planet comes very near to the sun, it moves faster, and when it goes away from the sun, it moves slower. That's what this law says. It, of course, in other words, it says aerial velocity is constant. Okay, the sectors which are shown, the time taken for this sector is same as the time taken for that sector, but the distance covered is less. So when it is far, it moves slower. When it is near, it moves faster. Third one says that this, you see, these are the three orbits which are possible. There is something common for these three orbits. This particular distance, which is also called semi-major axis of the ellipse, this is constant for the three, but this distance is different. It only means its eccentricity is different. Some of you know about ellipse, eccentricity is different. This is with eccentricity zero. Eccentricity can be different if the semi-major axis is same, time period for the orbit is same. That's what he told. This is a third law. Of course, it is told in complex mathematical equation, and everything is governed by these three laws. Okay? Of course, if you go further, everything is governed by universal law of gravitation. I told you, rocket has to take the satellite to a required height and impart a velocity. If it is a 500 kilometer height for Earth, then it has to impart a velocity of around 7.6 kilometers per second. My friends, 7.6 kilometers per second translates to what? Around 24,000, 25,000 kilometers per hour. Okay, that is the kind of velocity it has to impart if it has to go to 500. If it has to go higher up, the velocity it has to impart is lesser. But it may sometimes look nice. Okay, if you have to go higher up, velocity to be imparted is lesser. But it is not so. The rocket has two jobs to do. It has to take it to the height, impart the velocity. So it has to build the velocity, take it to that and release the satellite. So taking it to the height, to that particular height, also is the job of the rocket. Now, I will introduce a concept of what is called escape velocity. All this I have to build, otherwise I can't tell. My further talks will be going above your head. Now, escape velocity is the term that if you want to leave a planet, if you want to launch something from the planet, and you have to go escape from the gravitational influence of that planet, then you have to impart what is called escape velocity. This escape velocity value is different at different heights, at different altitudes. Using the word height is also altitude. If you take this, E stands for Earth radius. Earth radius is around 6,370 kilometers at equator. Now, if you take that height, I have taken that example, if around 6,400 kilometer height, then the velocity you have to give is 5.59 kilometers per second to put it in a circular orbit. My friends, please note, there is no object in this space which is in a perfectly circular orbit. Because if you put, even if you put in a circular orbit, within a fraction of a time, that orbit changes because of various factors which I will tell later. Okay, but just for completion, for explanation, I have used this. If you give this velocity, if you give a velocity anything above this, then it gets into elliptical orbit at this height. If you give a velocity 7.91 kilometers per second at this altitude, above 7.91 kilometers per second, it is escaping, it is going to into an orbit, and it is escaping the sphere of influence of Earth, gravitational sphere of influence of Earth. This escape velocity puts it in an orbit called hyperbolic orbit. I'll come to that. Show the shape of the orbit later. If you impart the velocity here, it will get into this orbit, it will go into an orbit in such a way, with respect to Earth, it never returns. That is the way it is. But it will be, while going, it will be going, it encounters the gravitational force of any other body, it gets affected, accordingly orbit changes. Okay? Otherwise, it is simply traveling in that orbit. I told you that rocket has to impart a velocity. Now, velocity is a vector. Vector means what? It has got a magnitude, it has got a direction. Velocity 5.59 can be in different directions. Same velocity, if you give in different directions, it will get into different orbit. This is Earth. This is Earth. You see, I told you that 5.59, if you give in a particular velocity, particular direction, it gets into circle. Same velocity, with the same magnitude, but direction different. Then same speed, I would say. Speed is same, but velocity is different. It gets into different kind of orbits. That means the position of Earth with respect to the orbit changes. That you should understand. Basically, it means semi-major axis changes. I showed you on semi-major axis. That changes. But all are in same plane. Now, I told you a Kepler second law, I told you. It moves faster when it is near. It moves slower when it is further. If you take roughly an orbit, something like 36,000 kilometers altitude orbit, you see at that distance, it will move at the velocity of 1.6 kilometers per second. When it is near Earth, it will move at 10.1 kilometers per second. Sometimes there is no time available, but this will create some problem. Whenever we pass very near to Earth, we have something called Earth atmospheric effect. And the satellite moves. When you're running, you feel the air is pressing you. You get the feeling. That is there for satellite, especially our satellite has got a solar panel, big solar panel. Depending on what area cross-section is facing the atmosphere, then it will create some it is called atmospheric drag effect. The velocity reduces. So all these things are there. So more number of times you pass through this will come down. Now, a little bit further on this. I talked about semi-major axis. In the ellipse, this is called semi-major axis. This is called semi-minor axis. And if you take this focus, this is where Earth is, or here to here distance. If you call it a C, C by A is called eccentricity. Let us take it like that today. And it becomes, eccentricity becomes zero for a circle, because this will coincide with this point for circle. So C becomes zero, so eccentricity becomes zero. For this point, for a satellite around Earth, is called apogee, and nearest point is called perigee. Please remember this, I will be using these terms here afterwards. For a satellite going around moon, they are called aposelene, periselene. Selene means moon. Satellite right now, our Mars, Mangalyaan, going around Mars, it is called apomars, perimars. Our Earth goes in an orbit around Sun, it is called apohelion, perihelion. Now, the semi-major axis, if it changes, then the shape of the orbit changes. Ellipse shape changes. Eccentricity changes. Then ellipse becomes, it goes towards becoming circle. That is basically this shape. Semi-minor axis change, but semi-major axis remaining same, eccentricity changes, it becomes like this. There is one more. Now, I decided semi-major axis, eccentricity, it divided the orbit, the plane. We decided the orbit plane. Now, orbit can be in any plane with respect to globe. Oh, very good. Orbit can be like this, orbit can be like this, orbit can be like this. What does it mean? The orbit plane what angle it makes with the equator is called the inclination. I am now trying to fix the orbit, okay, in the 3D space. Okay, one by one I am going. First two things are divided, the shape and size of the orbit. Shape and size, but in a plane. Now that plane, what angle it makes with the equatorial plane is called the inclination. If eccentricity is 0, I told you it will be a circle. Between 0 and 1, it will be an ellipse. Of course, there is no orbit like this. This is a parabola. Eccentricity 1, there is no orbit like that. I told you, if you give escape velocity, it gets into an hyperbolic orbit. If you give escape velocity, this hyperbolic orbit, hyperbola is like this. It goes into one of the sections of hyperbola. Four sections are there. You give escape velocity, it travels in this continuously in space. Until and unless Newton's first law. Until and unless it gets influenced by some other force. Now, inclination, this orbital inclination, if it is different, the orbits look like this. This is called polar orbit, 90 degrees. Near 90 degrees also are called polar orbits, 98, 95, like that. Then, if the orbit is, inclination is between 0 to 90, it is called prograde and retrograde. I have to tell you something about this. Prograde means, for example, if any planet or a satellite moves, it rotates or moves in the same direction as the, it spins around itself, moves in the same direction and moving, spinning direction is such that it is same as the direction in which it moves around sun, it is called prograde. There are two planets in our solar system which are retrograde, Venus and Uranus. On Uranus, sun rises in the west and sets in the east. That's all it means. Okay. Now, this is, you should understand retrograde and prograde. There is one particular orbit where I equal to 0. This orbit, I'll come to that later. Most of our, almost all of our communication satellites are in this equatorial orbit. If the orbit is in the equator, inclination is 0. There are some more things. Now I fixed. What I fixed? I fixed the orbital plane. I fixed what angle it makes with the equator. But still, angle if it makes me inside, I have an orbit like this. But angle I fixed. Now orbit can be like this, it can be like this, it can be like this, it can be in parallel planes. There are thousands of parallel planes possible. Now, where you fix the plane, that is coming through two more parameters. This parameter basically called ascending node. The place where the orbit cuts the ecliptic plane. Ecliptic plane is the plane in which all planets move around sun. Okay, where it cuts, that is called ascending. Again, there will be that side descending. The longitude of that is called, this will fix the plane. Okay, now within orbit also, the shape fully we have not fixed now. We have not fixed it, it can be rotating. An ellipse in a plane, it can be this way, this way, this way. That is fixed by this. These are the parameters which fix an orbit. I have to tell this and then proceed. Now, let us go into details of different kinds of orbits. First, I will take those satellites which are used for communication. Our TV channels. You know, you have 300s of TV channels. You have that dish antenna, DTH. Every house, there is a dish antenna now. And you know that antenna is mounted, and it is looking in one direction. That antenna, morning till evening, always it is looking in one direction. And you receive the signal. Now, satellites are going around the Earth, but it is looking in one direction. Does it mean, it means what? When you are moving, your Earth is moving, your dish antenna is moving, it means that in this direction, 36,000 kilometers away, there is a satellite which is also moving similarly. Synchronous, geosynchronous, means synchronous with respect to Earth. Okay, that's what it means. It has got two parameters. First one, it has to be, its orbital period has to be 24 hours. Earth takes 24 hours to go around itself. It is 23 hours, 56 minutes. All those things are there, the exact number. It takes that much time. So satellite also has to take the same amount of time. If you satisfy that condition, it is called geosynchronous. Geosynchronous orbit means synchronous with respect to Earth. But I can have an orbit. For that, the high satellite has to be at 36,000 kilometers. If 36,000 kilometer height, a circular orbit, it will take 24 hours. Now, orbit can be like this. It can be like this. It will take 24 hours. It can be like this. It can be like this. These are all called, once it is at 36,000 kilometers, it is called geosynchronous. But it will not be geostationary. I will come to that. Your DTH antenna will remain stationary looking at the orbit, provided second condition is satisfied. Second condition is orbit should be in the equatorial plane. means inclination should be zero. Orbit should be on the equator only. It cannot be like this. 24-hour orbit we can have this way also, but it has to be like this. Okay. Now what happens if you have this with respect to any longitude? You take a longitude. Longitude, if you position the satellite 36,000 from here and the Earth moves like this, your satellite also moves like this, then it looks stationary. On the longitude, anywhere it looks stationary because only your antenna has to move. If you are in the northern hemisphere, you move slightly southwards if you are on the equator. These two conditions are required for making the satellite geostationary. Geostationary means two conditions satisfied. Geosynchronous means only 24 hours. Okay? All the communication satellites of our INSAT class, GSAT class, they are in this orbit. This concept was suggested through almost a fiction by Arthur Clarke long back, much before communication satellites came into existence. He proposed that if you have satellites at 36,000 kilometers, three of them 120 degrees apart on equator, then you can cover most of the globe. Because you can't cover some portions of the, depending on field of view of antenna, some portions near the poles you can't cover. But you can cover, that is how the whole idea originated. Okay. Now, let us understand what happens, why the satellite has to be on the equator only. Why orbit has to be in the equator? Imagine the orbit is with a inclination of, consider this, if it is on the equator, it will look like this. This is latitude, longitude. Throughout it will look like this. At this particular longitude, it will look on the equator. That is why it is stationary from Earth. If it is making an angle of, suppose this is 5 degrees. Suppose it is making a 5 degree angle with equator. Then your dish antenna, when it is looking at it, every day it has to make, the satellite appears to move in an 8 shape. 24 hours, it moves. At some times, twice it goes to an extreme end of 5 degrees. And only twice it comes to the this thing. When it comes here, suppose if you have an antenna, if you have such a satellite, time is not there. I will tell a story. In the beginning, Udaya News, Udaya TV, when it came first time, it used a satellite called AsiaSat. That AsiaSat satellite, already fuel was getting depleted. It had built an inclination. And that inclined satellite was used by Udaya when it came first. Initial days, I am telling, so many years back. And it used to be told that certain times in the day, Udaya TV signal is not okay. I mean, it is not, because what happens when you go to extreme end, if you don't move the antenna in 8 shape exactly like this over 24 hours, then when it goes to the extreme end, you position the antenna here only, then somewhere twice in the day, you will get signal will become weaker, you may not receive the signal. So this is important. Inclination should not be there. It should be on the equator. Now, how do we put the satellites into this orbit? 36,000 kilometers on the equator. If you take our GSLV or PSLV, generally it puts into an orbit like this. It's called transfer orbit. You take I will take the example of our, not the PSLV, I'll take the example of our Ariane, where we take satellites to French Guiana sometimes and launch, you know that. Generally, Ariane gives us this orbit, where this distance is 36,000 kilometers, and this will be anywhere from 300 to 500, 600 kilometers. So perigee will be at that, and apogee will be here. What we do, this is the orbit in which it is launched. We transform this orbit to the final orbit. How do we do it? What we do is, on the satellite, there is a motor called liquid apogee motor. Recent days, you would have heard so much about LAM. This LAM has done wonders for Mangalyaan. Okay, the same LAM which is there on that, and we carry liquid propellant. There is a tank which contains the liquid propellant, and we using the liquid propellant, this motor is such that we can fire it for the duration we want, and then shut it down and fire it again. So what we do, we orient the motor this way. If you orient the motor this way, if satellite is going this way, if you orient the motor this way and fire, the velocity increases. By firing it in particular direction, this direction means that and the satellite is moving this direction, you fire it here, it velocity increases. When it increases, instead of coming back in this orbit, it goes into this orbit. That means mainly, we say perigee increases. This, using this motor, we can increase the velocity, we can decrease the velocity. Basically, we can change the size of the orbit. Okay. I am talking of one level now. We can even change the plane of the orbit. I'll come to that later. Okay. Then, we do this at several instants, different apogees. That is why it is also called, LAM is also called, we used to call it as apogee motor fire. We used to call it as ABM, apogee boost motor. That was the name we used to give earlier. Because mostly we used to use it as apogee. But today, we use it as apogee, perigee, so many places. So we call it as liquid apogee motor. Okay. Even then, A stands there. Apogee, some apogee is continuing. Okay. Then, this is how we increase the perigee. Now, if the launch vehicle puts it in the equator, the first orbit, then we don't have to change the inclination. It is not that. Actually, launch vehicle, when it gives the orbit, there will be minor inclination. When we do this firing, we also take care of, in the consecutive maneuvers, we take care of bringing down the plane so that it matches with the equator. What we do, we correct the inclination also. So exactly the orientation in which we fire this LAM is decided addressing semi-major axis and inclination. So the orientation is decided based on the orientation we fire. This is a very, very complex process. Lot of calculations involved. I made it so simple to you. Okay, this is how we change the orbit and bring it to final. When we come to final orbit, it will be near 24 hours. And it will be on the equator near 24 hours. Now, we call it the drift orbit. If it is less than, slightly less than 24 hours, every day, it appears to drift sidewise. That is, either it will drift, if it is more or less, it will drift east or west every day. Because size, it's not exactly 24 hours. Earth moves in 24 hours. So we finally, what we do, we shut down this liquid apogee motor and we use other propulsion systems in the satellite, and with that we correct this minor corrections. We call drift corrections. This is the case of GSAT-12, which was launched by PSLV. GSAT-12 mass is such that with that PSLV is able to put it in a sub-GTO orbit. It is called geosynchronous transfer orbit, sub-GTO. That means this is not 36,000 kilometers. It will be around 20 and odd. Okay. So, this kind of an orbit, and this will be around 250 kilometers. There is an inclination of almost 17 to 19 degrees. This inclination, that kind of orbit it puts. Now, how do we change this orbit? What we do, we first fire at perigee and increase the apogee. We have to bring the apogee to 36,000 first. So, here we fire at perigee and increase the apogee. See, it increased the apogee. One more. Yeah, twice we did this. To bring it to GTO. GTO means this is 36,000 kilometers. Till now, we have not addressed the inclination. Inclination remains 17 degrees. Then, what we did is, afterwards, we have to increase the perigee to 36,000 and correct the inclination. That's what we did in further maneuvers. That's what. You see, it increased and we have reduced the... Finally, we have come to the, what is it called, drift orbit. Still, it is not 24 hours and we do the minor correction. This also, there are several strategies followed for different missions, depending on the mass of the satellite and corresponding to mass, the rocket's capability and what orbit rocket has put. This is like a combination of how much fuel you carry in rocket, how much capability rocket has got, and what is your satellite mass and what amount of propellant you have got in your satellite. It's a complex calculation. With that we do. Having told that this about this geostationary orbit, having told about this. Now, finally, what happens, it becomes geostationary with respect to Earth. Means in one longitude, 36,000 kilometers away, it is stationary. Means satellite is on a longitude. Okay? That means these are slots. Every country, organization which puts communication satellites are allotted these slots. In 36, imagine from Earth, 36,000 kilometers away on the equator, there is an orbit. That is what it is. This picture is a very old picture and a situation at that time. I think it should be more than 7-8 year old picture. And you see several agencies have put their satellites. Whatever you see in this color here are all that time the Indian slot. This process of getting this slot itself is a very complex process. One has to file application telling the slot which you want and with which frequency you will radiate from there. And based on that, there is a complex process based on a slot is allotted. I can only tell one thing, having allotted the slot within a certain time, I think now it is 3 months or 4 months, or 6 months. Within that, you have to take one object there and radiate with that frequency. Otherwise, you lose the slot. So these are all. This is all done by ITU, an organization at the international level, because all countries have their communication satellites. Whole world communication works on this. Now, if you have one slot, doesn't mean that slot. For example, one slot you have. We have an 83 degree slot. 83 degree slot plus minus 0.1 degree, some slot is given to you, that is the area. When you translate it at 36,000 kilometers, it becomes 200 kilometers. You can keep any number of satellites you want, but radiating with the same frequency which you throw. Okay, that frequency range, that is the range. Now, this is called co-location. It is a very, very complex strategy. You can keep any number of satellites. This, you see, at this is also slightly older slide. Five slots, we have more slots now. You see, in one slot, we have four satellites. Some slots, we have three satellites. Initially, we put one satellite. Then when we take other satellite, we do what is called as a co-location strategy in such a way that we manage the inter-satellite distance in such a way that within that point, plus minus 0.1 degree, we are able to manage. Today, your dish antenna, when you look at one direction, it is able to get hundreds of channels. Please note one thing, all of them don't come by one satellite. Some of them come by multiple satellites. The field of view of the antenna is such that multiple satellites are visible to them. Okay, so this is all done because one slot you can keep multiple number of satellites. This itself is a very complex strategy. Before going to sun synchronous orbit, I have to tell you one thing. Now this problem is there, 36,000 kilometers, so many satellites, and many will have a doubt about what happens when the satellite life is over. Life is over means it can be because of fuel or it can be because of many other reasons. When the life is generally based on fuel, when the life is about to be over, generally what is done is before the satellite life is over, certain propellant is planned for doing what is called as reorbiting. Reorbiting is we take the satellite up by another 150-200 kilometers. That is what this is called end of life operation. And this orbit about 150-200 is called a graveyard orbit. So we take it there and leave it. It takes several years to come to that that region of 36,000. That is what is done. All countries are following it now. Why we are following? Slot is ours. All satellites in the slot is ours. So it should not cause problem. These dead satellites are always a problem. So this is what is done. Similar things are there, what is called deorbiting for near earth satellites. There is some concept called sun synchronous orbiting. These are used for remote sensing satellites. Remote sensing satellites are satellites in the near earth orbit. They are in the range of 600 to 1000 kilometers. There are about, I would say, 7 or 8 of the active, currently working remote sensing satellites of India, which are orbiting around earth. And this is doing human service. Common man will not know this. Common man will know only when TV channel is not there. Communication satellite, but these satellites also stop working. There are a lot of departments in government of India will come to stand still today. You talk of agriculture, geology, mineralogy, hydrology, urban development, you talk anything, every one of them making use of these remote sensing satellites. Okay, these satellites are in a different kind of orbit. What is these satellites supposed to do? They are supposed to do earth imaging. When I use earth imaging, please note this, imaging not only in visible spectrum, basically electromagnetic spectrum. With respect to that, and the information is not only about surface, even inside information will come about minerals, about water, anything. I will not go that detail today. So this satellite, what it should do, suppose it is optical remote sensing, that is sun rays when they fall, what is reflected, what wavelengths are reflected out of it are measured, based on that you say what it is. This is called optical remote sensing. If you have to do optical remote sensing, every day when you image in a particular region, sun intensity has to be constant. If you come over Bangalore one day, another day you come over Bangalore, it is better if you have the same sun intensity. So it should be that kind of orbit. And that is what is sun synchronous. That suppose the satellite goes around on Bangalore today. Okay. When the satellite goes, it generally takes 1.5 hours. This 600 to 1000 kilometers orbit, 1.5 hours. After 1.5 hours, the satellite comes back, but Earth would have moved eastwards. So, satellite may pass over Arabia, possible. Okay, suppose it had passed over India when it was 9:30 in the morning. Okay, at Bangalore it was 9:30. When it comes second time, Bangalore will be 11 o'clock. Whereas the place where it passes, on that longitude it will be 9:30 local time. That is the way orbit is adjusted. Then it goes one more round and comes back. Bangalore time will be 12:30. That second place will be 11 o'clock. The place where it passes, there local time will be 9:30. Now, you take any latitude, on that latitude also when it passes, the time will be same. That is the way it is. Local time. It's local time. Means what? Local time is sun intensity. Okay. So, to make sun intensity constant, this. For that, what is done? Generally, you see the second line. Sun's apparent motion with respect to Earth is around 0.985 degrees, see, almost 1 degree per day. Earth takes 360 degrees in 365 days, so around 1 degree per day. So 0.9856 degrees per day. Sun's apparent motion. So you have to make your orbital plane also, you should make it shift with the same rate. That is the sun synchronous motion. Orbital inclination, I, it has to be more than 90 degrees for this purpose. There is an equation in which this, I talked about the point at which the orbit crosses the equator, capital omega. Rate of motion of that you have to take. The equation involves a minus cos I somewhere, and cos I remains negative in 90 degrees to 180 degrees. Minus cos I has to be positive 0.9856. That is why this orbit has to be more than 90 degrees. So that is how it is. Generally, all our sun synchronous orbits, our remote sensing orbits are around 98 degrees. One point I have to tell here, I told you the satellite passes over a particular place, local time is same. It's there, the time is same. So any remote sensing satellite, generally polar orbit, because it covers the globe totally, polar orbit, and when it is told that time at which it crosses the equator and the longitude at that, the time is called local time. So our satellites are there, IRS satellites, our remote sensing satellites, 9:30 local time. Some are there with 10 local time, 10:30 local time. There is one OceanSat, oceanography satellite. It requires a local time of 12 degrees, 12 hours, 12 noon. This is called noon midnight orbit, 12 noon. Because of oceanography, it has to pass over ocean at 12 noon for imaging. So these are all different requirements. So you can put it at different local time orbits. These are sun synchronous orbit. It is a very important orbit from the point of view of remote sensing. Now, how the remote sensing happens, a typical animation is there. The satellite is approaching over North Pole to South Pole. From North, it is approaching. And when it is approaching, when it is coming over India, the camera will be switched on. And when the camera is switched on, you see this area is imaged. This area is imaged. This is called swath. This to this is called swath. Now, some satellites, what kind of, in how many days you can cover whole India? How many days you can cover whole world? Decides the orbit as well as the swath. Now the swath also in turn decides the orbit. Now you see, resolution decides the orbit because altitude decides the resolution. Everything is interconnected. Now the required orbit for a remote sensing satellite is totally driven by its application. If it is an agriculture satellite, if it is an oceanography satellite, it has to be 12 noon local time. Like that, there are several factors. Based on that, orbit gets decided. Now when a satellite with an inclination of 60 degrees, suppose it has got an inclination of 60 degrees, how does its orbit look on the world, on the our Earth? It looks like going apparently in this motion. This is 60 degree latitude. So this is the way it goes. And this, from here to here, it will be roughly 1.5 hours for this kind of orbits. So roughly 14 to 15 times per day, it will be going around the Earth. If you look at all orbits, coverage looks like this. Now you see, this is India. And Bangalore station may be here. The satellite, the station can see the satellite only for when it is within this circle. This is called a visibility circle. Your horizon, when you look at horizon, when sun rises, you see when the sun rises from horizon, you see him, and then sunset. You see it for 12 hours. Okay. So similarly for anything, you can say, these satellites are going once in 1.5 hours. So roughly, something like when it is going in overhead from here to here, it is something like 13 minutes. So these kind of satellites, you can track only for 13 minutes. Remaining time, it is out of track. Now, this brings in a lot of complexity with respect to satellite management, so many things. That is why you need multiple ground stations. Before going into that visibility circles, multiple ground stations, let us see what this has got a direct bearing on the orbit. That's why I have told. Remote sensing satellites are organized in such a way that this is a typical remote sensing satellite called IRS-1D. And this satellite, when first day it will go in this way. I showed you that remote sensing swath. Each color is a swath. Okay. First day, first orbit, it will go here. 1.5 hours later, when it comes, it will be going here, roughly 2,800 kilometers away. Okay. So then next day, first orbit, it will come, it is adjusted in such a way that it comes just next to this. By doing this, satellite can be adjusted to cover the globe in 11 days, 22 days, Typically, this satellite was covering 22 days. 22 days, like that. This is called repetitivity. Repetitivity means an area, if you image, 22 days later you can image. Sometimes there is a repetitivity requirement of 11. You can keep a satellite in one orbit and another satellite in the same orbit, 180 degrees apart, and make it together, both of them together. Same instrument you can put in both the satellites. You can make it together 11 days. Now, all these things are possible. Okay. You can have put three satellites, and make them cover in 5.5 days. So like that. You can have a satellite on which you can have the camera, the tilting capability. When it comes, you can make it look this way, that way. That is called revisit. Even though it passes over this, you can image some other area. By this, you can reduce the time over which you can image a particular period. When all these factors decide the orbit requirement. I have already told about this, maybe you will just skip. What happens is when satellite rises from here to here, this period only you will be able to see the from the station. That is why for near Earth satellites, you need multiple stations. For 36,000 kilometer orbit, when it is finally in geostationary orbit, Hassan station alone can track it once it is in the final orbit. Till it is final orbit is achieved, we use stations, multiple stations all over the globe. Afterwards, it is only Hassan station or Bhopal station which will track those satellites. Whereas our near Earth satellites, we use several stations. These are all our own stations. For example, Mauritius, we have a station. Indonesia, Biak, we have a station. Bangalore, Lucknow, like that we have stations. We had earlier stations in Russia, but now it is not there. What we do, initial few days, we use the station from in Germany, and Germany, Weilheim. Then we use the station in US. Like that, we use multiple stations. But once it comes into final operation, or even for nearer satellites, because we do imaging, mostly we receive the data. When imaging data, immediately we have to receive only when it is over India. Otherwise, what we do, when we go to other countries, we use a solid state recorder on board, record the data, and when it comes over India, we play it back. So turnover time will be more, that data will get delivered later. So this is the concept here, says why we need multiple stations. Satellites also undergo eclipse. Just like your lunar eclipse, solar eclipse, here what is explained is a typical solar eclipse. Typical solar eclipse, basically, it shows that the Earth shadow falls on the, Moon shadow falls on this Earth. That's what happens. Okay, so let us go to the next one. What happens to our satellites? When satellite comes in the shadow of Earth, Earth comes in between satellite and the Sun, then this is a very great impact on satellite. Because when the shadow is there, our solar panels don't generate the power. So we need to, this is the reason why we need to carry the battery. So sizing of the battery, the kind of the characteristics of the battery, how many times, discharge, charge, so many things, everything gets decided by the orbit. Please note this. That is finally the orbit. Typically suppose there is a remote sensing satellite, 900 kilometers. It undergoes an eclipse of 33 minutes in every orbit. 1.5 hours it goes behind the Earth. So every orbit there will be an eclipse. Whereas if you take this geostationary orbit, around March and September, only around March and September, few days, around midnight, there will be eclipse. Now, their requirements are different. The way we manage this is totally different. The requirements are different. But I just want to tell the orbit effect here, that's why I'm not going into the other details. If you live in an orbit, it immediately changes. What are the factors changing the orbit? Four factors are there. First one I will just deal with because I don't have a slide for this. Every school, every college, this kind of globe is given. This is not the shape of the Earth. You know that. Even in the show, it was shown even Mars doesn't have this shape. It is bulging at the equator and flattened at the poles. Okay, not only that, it is not a perfect globe. So gravity value, which you call 9.81, whatever you call, that is not constant all through. In fact, gravity value varies, especially it is much more at the equator. This is called oblateness of the Earth, asphericity of the Earth. Because of that, the gravitation value changes. So because of that, orbits get changed. This is first effect. Second effect is aerodynamic drag. Let me show it by a diagram. Atmosphere, I told you, when you run against the atmosphere, the pressure which it creates, you feel that pressure. Because of that, velocity changes. So that changes the orbit. Whenever our satellite passes in this region, then the semi-major axis changes and this will come down. After some time, it will become like this. And if you leave it like this, a stage will come when it will come and enter the Earth atmosphere. Now, this is atmospheric drag effect. Third one is solar radiation. The solar radiation also has got a, it creates a pressure. Depending on what is the shape of satellite, what is the area of cross section exposed to solar solar radiation, it creates the pressure. And because of that, once again, it changes the, primarily it changes the semi-major axis. The if you leave it in circular orbit, it changes to elliptical orbit. These kind of effects are there. I have told one more, lunisolar tidal effects. This variation of distance of Earth and Moon, and also Moon and Sun, these variations, in addition to that, position of the way in which Earth, Sun and Moon are positioned, these things create what are called as tidal effects. And these also affect on the satellite, and these tidal effects, is, we call it tidal effect, but tides show that effect, if the effect it will show, the cause of that affects the satellite also. So that is the fourth force. What happens because of this? For nearer satellites, we need to do corrections. Because of orbit change, we need to do corrections. In fact, each one of them can be told for 15 minutes. So I have just put the value. I told you, satellite has to pass over Bangalore at a particular time. For any remote sensing satellite, for a systematic coverage satellite, we give a calendar. Earlier it's a path calendar. We say in the whole year, every day, at what time, which place it will come. And it has to come there. That is how remote sensing scientists use it. Now, because of this difference, the orbit path shifts. So we need to do what is called path locking. This ground track overcomes, it shifts this way, that way. So we need to do track control. Both of them mean semi-major axis correction. Okay. Then local time control. I told you it has to pass over equator at a particular time on a longitude. I told that. And we promised the remote sensing scientists, this is what will be done. We have to maintain that. This is inclination correction. If inclination changes, local time changes. Obviously, if inclination changes, position of sun with respect to the plane relatively changes. Okay? So that is that. I told about reorbiting for 36,000 kilometer orbit. Here, there is a thing which is supposed to be done by all countries, is once the satellite life is over, nearer satellite, before that, we are supposed to use the last some portion of fuel to make it enter the Earth atmosphere deliberately so that it burns off. Nothing will, you know, it is only burns off. It's only to take care that pieces are not left in the around Earth. This is the big issue today, space debris. Space debris mitigation measure. There is a body called IADC, a lot of things are there. So it is supposed to be followed. Few countries are following it. Unlike in geostationary satellites, there is a thought given to us, everything is ours only inside that. But here it is not so. So it is being followed, but not to that extent. For geostationary satellites, I told you, because of this orbit change, IE change, it drifts. It is supposed to be in one longitude, but it will move east-west. If the major axis changes, period changes, it will move this way, that way. It is called east-west shift. We do once in a while something called east-west station keeping. Sometimes inclination changes, very rarely we do inclination correction, bring it to equator, and we call it a north-south station keeping. And I have already told you, in the end, we have to move it to graveyard orbit. Now I will come to a topic of going out of Earth's sphere of influence. Earth's gravitation sphere of influence spreads up to 918,000 kilometers. Earth's gravitational sphere of influence extends up to that. Earth's gravitation affects until then. Similarly, Mars has got a figure here, and I will not go into the details. If you want to leave Earth and go into a move towards another planet, you have to impart what is called an escape velocity. So generally, there are four phases in that. You have to be first, you have to be in Earth-centric phase. Around Earth, you can put it to the orbit around Earth. There are some rockets which will impart directly the escape velocity. There are some rockets which have done, depending on the mass of the satellite and the capability of the rocket. Our Mangalyaan weighed 1,350, around 1.4 tons while launch. Our PSLV did not have the capability to impart escape velocity to that. So we took it to a path, I will show the an animation. We took it to a path, we went around Earth, and then we finally imparted escape velocity. Then once you give escape velocity, you go into a heliocentric phase. I told you hyperbolic orbit. When I say hyperbolic, with respect to Earth, it is hyperbolic. But it is in an orbit around Sun, because it is being acted by the gravitational influence of Sun. Okay, that is what it is. Then third, last stage is, we arrange the orbit in such a way the object with which we want to rendezvous, Mars, for example. Its orbit we see, and we plan this orbit in such a way that both come near. And at some time we plan the rendezvous, and that is where we call it as insertion into the planet orbit. 24th morning, what happened with respect to Mangalyaan is this. We call it as MOI, Mars orbit insertion. When we did it for Chandrayaan, we called it as LOI, lunar orbit insertion. That's all. Okay. Then afterwards, we get into an orbit around the object, around Mars or any planet. These are the four stages we go through. That is given pictorially. You see, around Earth, then you increase the velocity, and then you come to give a velocity such a way that it gets into an orbit which is heliocentric. Next. I have already told this, so let me... Now, let us first see how it was done in Chandrayaan. Okay. First I will see Chandrayaan and then I will get into everything about orbits only. I am telling about orbits. PSLV put it into this orbit. That orbit is given here. 5 kilometers perigee and 23,000 kilometer apogee. PSLV. And we kept on firing our LAM at this point by which we increase the size of the orbit. EBN is earthbound maneuver. Earthbound maneuver. Earthbound maneuver means the satellite is still around Earth and we are doing maneuver to increase the size of the orbit. We kept on increasing the apogee by these steps, you see this. And when we launched, when the PSLV launched on October 22, 2008, the moon was here, maybe. Moon was here. We calculated where the moon is and how the moon is moving, and then we targeted the launcher inclination and the what is called an argument of perigee, the position of the perigee with respect to the orbit means origin of apogee, where the apogee is. We targeted that and kept on increasing such a way that after this maneuver, we reached this apogee height. You see this. This is almost same as the moon distance. And then we made the moon approach there. That time when we came to moon, we did a maneuver where we reduced the, basically we required orientation, we reduced the velocity of the satellite. I will, in very simple terms I am telling, in required orientation we reduce the velocity. That is what we did on 24th also for Mars. Okay. If you reduce the amount by which you reduce the velocity here to make it go around moon, if you reduce it too much, it will go and impact on moon. If you reduce it by slightly less than that is you don't do it enough, then it will fly by moon. It will go near the moon using gravitational force. Because of gravitational force, it will go to a different orbit to go away. It will go into the go further, it will not orbit around moon. That is called flyby mission. Okay. So this particular activity is a very, very complex activity as regard to the maneuver is concerned. Okay. That is why several nations have failed in this with respect to moon as well as with respect to Mars. Okay. So this is what we did for, you know, after getting into the orbit here, we got into this orbit around moon, and that is 7,500 apocylene, 496 pericylene. We changed this orbit. Finally, our aim was 100 by 100. So what we did? We reduced this point by firing the motor in a reverse direction here. You turn the motor 180 degrees and fire, the velocity reduces. If you reduce, you bring down this point. That's why we kept on reducing and then 100 by 100. Now, that is how we did in Chandrayaan. Now, I will show you how the same was achieved in Mangalyaan. Position the cursor here and click. The PSLV launched it into this orbit. Okay. Then we kept on firing the LAM here, kept on increasing the orbit. The values are all coming here. Kept on increasing the orbit. And finally, at one stage, we imparted the escape velocity and we made it go. It shows it is not the consecutive apogee perigee we didn't fire. There are specific perigees which are required to be fired. I will only tell this much. That is not that second apogee you fire, fourth apogee you fire. It's not like that. Selection when you have to fire depends on several factors. When you fire, there are so many conditions. Before that, there are several operations to be done. And all these operations when you do, ground stations which you use on the world should be able to see that. Ground station visibility becomes important. Ground station is a very costly resource here. I will come to that later. The ground stations we used for Mangalyaan are Bangalore ground station. We used Goldstone in US, Madrid in Canada, and Canberra in Australia. Madrid in Spain, Canada, Canberra in Australia. So these four stations, these stations are called deep space stations, deep space network stations, and using them is a costly affair. There are a lot of thousands of dollars to be paid for every second. It is not that easy. So we have to optimize as much as possible. When you say 450 crores when we did Mangalyaan, it means all these things are included in that. Okay, so this is the first stage. Now, what happens is this shown is the heliocentric phase. Now you see Earth and satellite are moving around Sun. Satellite is moving around Earth. This is the phase in which I showed you earlier. Okay, all those increases are happening. At this stage, we imparted the escape velocity and Earth started moving in this direction. Satellite started moving in this direction. This is the heliocentric. This is a hyperbolic orbit with respect to Earth. Okay, but with respect to Sun, it is in elliptic orbit. Okay, now this, you see Mars, it was coming from here, how you Mars and Earth are approaching. This was the situation few days earlier to 24th of September. And from this point to this point, it has taken 300 days. Okay, 300 days is, this is the point is November 30th. November 5th was the launch. November 30th was the escape velocity we gave. And September 24th of 2014 is the day we did the rendezvous with Mars. How this rendezvous happened is shown in the, see, it is approaching towards Mars and it gets captured. This is the point where we do that maneuver. In fact, the satellite was turned by 180 degrees and with after turning 180 degrees, lamp firing was done to reduce the velocity. Now, several things have happened here. The diagram doesn't picture, it shows the position of Sun. Sometimes there was an eclipse, sometimes there was an occult. Occult means Earth antenna is looking towards our Mangalyaan, but Mars will come in between. The period you will not be able to contact, you will not be able to establish contact. All these operations, I showed these operations, especially these operations and escape velocity giving operation, all of them, trans-mass injection we call it, all of them have been done autonomously. In the sense, we upload the commands much earlier, test it out. 24th operation, the commands were uploaded some 1 week earlier. I think if I am not wrong, 15th, 16th it was uploaded, and 16th, 17th, there was a simulation exercise one except firing. Everything was done. Everything was tested out. 300 days later, we have to use an equipment called LAMP, shut it down and then use it after 300 days. First time we have done it in our ISRO's history. And for that, several attempts have been done. The designers of that LAMP, in fact, designers, people who have done it are sitting here. In fact, now I will tell a little bit about when it orbits around a planetary or a satellite, how does it look for us? They have taken Moon, for example. Our Chandrayaan, when it reached there, 100 by 100, the orbit looks like this from Earth. Okay, now, sometime it will be going like this. This is called phase-on orbit. Phase-on means what? When it is in this orbit for a few days, so 3-4 days, all the time it will be visible to us. After some time, it will come to this orbit. Then it will come to this orbit. You see this, this is same as, this period is same as your Paksha, Krishna Paksha, Shukla Paksha, you know, 15 days. And in between it will come to this, this is called edge-on orbit. Satellite will not be visible when it is on the back side. Then again it comes like this, it comes like this. This planning of this orbit also is very important. Planning of this orbit with respect to position of Sun, where the Sun is, you know, Moon 1 day is almost 14 days, 14, 15 days. So, position of Sun, so many things play a role. For this audience, I am not going to the details of that, but there are several factors beyond what I am telling, which play the role of how do you design an orbit. How do you design an orbit around Moon decides how do you approach it. It decides how do you maneuver it. How do you capture it? How do you maintain it? Now, these are all very, very complex things. I would say Chandrayaan and Mangalyaan primarily is a flight dynamics mission, propulsion mission. Is orbit dynamics and the propulsion, primarily. Others, of course, other, definitely all other systems have played a very important role. Everything is important, but these are more complex. Now, I will come little bit on some other kind of satellites. You all of you know about GPS. I'm sure many of you know about GPS. This GPS system works based on a system of American satellites. There are 24 satellites, and concept is what? From any particular receiver, if you are at any time, minimum 4 satellites will be visible. The satellite orbits are like that. I will show the orbits later. The orbits are, there are 6 planes. There are about 6 planes, and each plane around 4 satellites. So it is, these planes are organized in such a way that, and they are at a distance of about 20,000 kilometers from Earth, from Earth's surface. And then they are organized in such a way, any point, at any time, your minimum 4 satellites will be visible. And these 4 satellites will transmit to your receiver about their position. They also transmit exact time about their position, and they will also transmit about their direction. You will be able to get with that. This is there is a very, very interesting mathematical problem inverse prism problem with which you will be able to decide the position, your position. This is the principle on which this works. All navigation satellites, most of them work in this principle. And whole world is using this system. This has been there for a long time. But now there are several countries which have started their own systems. Europe has got a system. They are building a system. Russia has got GLONASS. Chinese are building a system called BDU or something. They are also building a system. Like that, there are. India also is building a system like that. Now, anyway, this is an animation which is shown how the satellites move. If you are able to see carefully any point, your GPS will be able to see minimum four, not four. Sometimes you will see 9, 10 satellites also. We are building a system called IRNSS. Today, our many systems in India are depending on American systems, and there are many things which can Americans, you know, these systems can be denied. It is possible. Selectively, specific location signals can be denied. There are ways of doing it. So it is better that every country, that the country has, depends on its own, specifically for strategic application. So we are building a system called IRNSS. I will straight away go to the next diagram, so that it is a system of seven, to start with seven satellites, three satellites geostationary, four satellites geosynchronous. When I say geosynchronous, they are with an inclination, okay, four satellites, so seven satellites. In the region over India, spreading around 1500 kilometers from our coastal range, that side, this side. So it is almost covers region from here to here, this portion. It is going to provide GPS equivalent or even better service on this region. Once the system is up, two satellites are already up, one more will be up on 10th of October. I will show how that constellation comes up. These are three geostationary slots. Now, it was planned as geostationary. In the end, I will tell you it's a slight change in that. Next. So, that is a 34, 83 and 131.5 degree longitude. Next. Then, four satellites, two will be on this slot. Next. So, it is 29, that is 55 degrees and 111.5 degrees, four satellites with an inclination of 29 degrees. Earth, 29 degree inclination. When you make 29 degree, I showed you one picture, the animation there. It looks like moving in 8 shape, and that is what will happen for these satellites over 24 hours. Now, the direction of motion of these satellites is in the direction of motion of Earth's rotation, obviously. It's a 7 satellite constellation. First phase is 7 satellite constellation. There is a next phase which is 11 satellite constellation. There are 4 more slots in which only single satellite will be there, but with an inclination of, I think, around 50. Yeah, next. The 42 degrees inclination. Next. How these satellites move is coming now. Next. Yeah. See, these two satellites move in the 8 shape. Next. These also will move in the 8 shape. That is the way the satellites move. Now, you imagine these four are not there. Even then, even this one, these three and these four itself will provide over this region, concept of receiver seeing four satellites at a time. Minimum four satellites. Recently, there is a change done, I believe. Now, what has happened is, this is 51 degree. These two satellites are already up. These two. And on 10th October, this satellite is going to be launched. But I believe now, these satellites also is going to be put in a 5-degree inclination. 5-degree inclination. Recent study has shown that this putting 5-degree inclination gives a better, they call it a GDOP, dilution of precision. I will not explain that. Dilution of precision only tells geometric dilution of precision, how many satellites you can see, how wide they are with respect to your wider, the prism base, if it is wider, then your position determination will be better. So that's what. So this is the, on by this next year middle, 7 satellites will be up. You will have receivers with GPS button, IRNSS button. So IRNSS, if you press, it will use our satellite. And you will be self-sufficient. That is what I want to tell you. Now, some other kind of peculiar orbit. We are launching a satellite called AstroSat. This is, you have all heard of Hubble telescope. This is also a space telescope. Of course, it has got multiple instruments. It is called a multi-wavelength astronomy mission. It has got 5-6 instruments, very complicated satellite. It is being built, undergoing tests right now in ISRO Satellite Center. This will be put in an equatorial orbit. This is equatorial plane. that is equatorial plane, and it makes an angle of 6 degrees to that. Most of the astronomical observation satellites are in the equatorial plane. Now, this perfect equatorial plane, we are launching this with once again PSLV. So, because of that, we have a limitation of going to equatorial plane. But we should be as less as possible, because some of you would have heard of what is called SAA, South Atlantic Anomaly. There is a region in South Atlantic Ocean where the radioactive, some effects are there, and our satellites also get affected. So we don't want satellite to pass again and again in that region, and that comes much beyond 6 degrees, and that is why originally it was 8 degrees, now it is made 6 degrees. This orbit is 650 kilometers only, but it is in the equatorial plane, and it will be launched in 2015. Just to show you that different kind of orbits, I am just put this. I am coming to one more now. Next. I will introduce you to what is called Lagrange points first, because we are going to do a Lagrange mission. Lagrange points are points between any two planar bodies where the point at which the gravitational effect of both the bodies cancel to some extent. Now, Earth and Sun, you take. Between Earth and Sun is this point, which is about from Earth, about 1.5 million kilometers away from Earth. This point is the point at which Earth and Sun gravitational effects almost cancel. And this is the point of interest for astronomers, and more than that, space scientists, and more for astronomy, sun missions and all that. Now, similar points are there, 5 of them. This alone, there is a point beyond Earth also, behind Earth. There is a point beyond Sun. And if you complete this this triangle, equilateral triangle, then you get 1.L4 and L5. These are all called points where this condition is satisfied. This point, we are going to put one satellite called Aditya. I will tell you about the orbit of that. This is Earth. We are going to go into the similar way, like around Earth, PSLV will launch it. We keep on increasing the orbit. Finally, we come to this point. This is L1 point. And we will put in an orbit around this L1 point in a plane, almost a plane which is perpendicular to the equatorial plane, ecliptic plane. Ecliptic plane is the plane in which Earth moves around Sun. Equatorial plane is Earth equatorial plane. Ecliptic plane, if you take, it makes perpendicular to that an orbit we are going to put. That is Sun you take. Suppose a very nice Sun is there. There is a Sun. And this is Earth. I look at that. In between L1 point, I put this satellite and go in this orbit. Fantastic. One side you can observe Sun. Other side you can communicate with Earth. Okay? Nice, very nice. Maintenance of this orbit is very, very tough. The disturbances, our effects are much more. So this is going to be around 1.5 million kilometers away, and the size of this orbit is all mentioned here. It's a three-dimensional orbit. This orbit is not a perfect plane. It is a kind of a bend, and the three-dimensional orbit. We are going to put in that. This mission is going to happen in, maybe, I don't know, ISRO has to tell, but there's some work. Work is going on. Already a lot of work has been done on Aditya mission. And this is for observation and study of solar corona. Already there have been SOHO. If you have heard of a mission called SOHO, SOHO was in this point. Like that, there are missions in this point. I told you about L3, L4. L4, L5. L4 is also used for astronomy missions. The point which is behind Earth, L2, is used for astronomy. Like that, these are all points which are used, and very interesting points, and it is a challenge to put satellites into this point. Now, some more orbits. These are very old orbits. See, I told you, communication orbits are on the equator. Equator, make it geostationary. But what about the countries which are on the near pole? Russia, for example, near pole. So they used earlier different kind of orbits called Molinia orbits. These Molinia orbits are very highly elliptic orbits. This distance is not 36,000. Okay, it is less than that. But the orbits are such that satellite dwells most of the time in this region. If it takes total time, suppose it takes 12 hours, around 10 hours it will be in this region. Now, Earth, it keeps in such a way that this region of the Earth you can use for communication. I am sure one satellite, you can keep multiple satellites. You can keep multiple satellites, they are phased in such a way that one satellite is here, another satellite is here. You can keep it, or in different planes also. Okay, now this is a Molinia orbit. The ground trace, I showed you one ground trace that time. It showed like this. That looks like this for this kind of orbit on Earth. In this time it dwells, if you take the total orbit from here to here, it dwells 90% of the time in this region. So the countries in this area will be able to use for communicating. But it is not a geostationary orbit. I just introduced you to another, they are called Molinia orbits. Okay, they are called apogee dwell orbits. They dwell more near the apogee. I will tell about one more mission because all of you have heard of Voyager. It is one of the three, I would say, man-made objects which have gone beyond our solar system. Pioneer 2 missions also have gone. So this Voyager 2 was launched in 77. Purpose of the Voyager 2, its objective is to study the Kuiper belt. Kuiper belt is beyond Neptune. And this is the belt in which most of the short orbital period comets originate. Comets, now who have a short orbital period, they visit quite often. Those comets, many of them originate from Kuiper belt. Okay. This Kuiper belt, to study the Kuiper belt was the objective. But while going, it has studied many planets. Okay. So it has had a, it didn't have a rendezvous or this thing with Mars. Directly it had a flyby with Jupiter. That was 9th July 1979. Then it had a flyby by Saturn 25th August. Then Uranus, then Neptune. Now it has crossed Neptune in 89 itself. Okay. This is the only mission which is the farthest from us. Farthest man-made object from us. Even now signals are being received. The power system uses RTG here. So because of that they are able to use it and it's expected to work till 2020. Why I showed this is to show you the kind of orbit which has been, this is an orbit which has been maneuvered every time. Every planet gravity has been used for changing its course. Even Mars it has not done any study, but Mars gravity has been used to change its course. It has been done like that. This is Voyager. Similarly, there is Voyager 1, then Pioneer, 2 Pioneers, there are several missions like that. Just for interest, I showed this to you. Present velocity is 15 kilometers per second with respect to Sun. When we tell velocity, you know when we talked of velocity, we talked of the velocity of Mangalyaan for some time in 20s, 20 and odd kilometers per second. Then suddenly we talked of 5.5 kilometers per second. 5.5 kilometers per second with respect to Mars, but 20 point something kilometers per second with respect to Sun. So, that is, when you talk of a vector, you talk with respect to a particular body. Now, this is my last slide. I just wanted to show you this orbit and then only, you know, end my lecture. ISEE3, International Sun Earth Explorer, it was launched in 1978. Originally, it was meant for Sun exploring. Obviously, it was to be put in L1. This is L1 point. This is L1 point. Somewhere L1 is written here. Halo orbit. It is in halo orbit. It was taken there. It was kept in halo orbit for quite some time in 82. But after the mission was over, the purpose of the mission was changed for comet intercept, for intercepting comets. Then onwards, you see how the trajectory has been taken, like that. Though it has done two comets, in fact, Glacobin and then Comet Halley. It has intercepted each of the comets. Now, what I wanted to show you here is, this orbit is not on its own. It has been maneuvered to take into this orbit. It means what? If we have sufficient propellant, sufficient capability, we can change the orbit and take it wherever we want. That is all. It is all a complex physics and mathematics. And of course, capability of the satellite systems. That's all I wanted to say. I think this is my last slide. Thank you very much. I try to convey about what is a satellite, what makes satellite to go into the orbit, basics, then tell about how to make the satellite go into different orbit, what are different orbits for different applications, and how to get out of the air of millions of any planet, and then how to maneuver, what are the forces which disturb the orbit, how to correct it, how to maintain it in the orbit in which we intend to keep it, and then also cover some other peculiar kind of orbits for different applications, even covering some little bit about Voyager, and these are generally every one of my lecture, I end with these photos. These are the people who led ISRO from the front, and because of them, we are where we are today. I have been in ISRO since 1973, my colleagues are also there, they have been there for a long time. We have been there right from the starting era. It was, you know, Dr. Vikram Sarabhai, Professor Vikram Sarabhai, it was his dream in 50s and 60s, which made us to have today total about 25 satellites, communication, remote sensing, navigation, name anything, and then go to all these processes, and then application in terms of communication, remote sensing, touching every walk of man's life. Is, and a country like India today cannot live without satellites and rockets. It is important. Building satellite rocket technology to launch our own satellite. Now go to the extent of launching even foreign satellites. So many things. He is the man behind. Then of course we have been led by all these great people. Professor Satish Dhawan, I will not go into the details. Professor Satish Dhawan was the time, he took over the time when there were failures. And he is the man who led through failures. And in space technology, every failure is a lesson for us. Every failure gives a lot of inputs for us. Failures are so important for space technology. Okay, and through his time only, SLV, ASLV happened, which are the basic stone for today PSLV, which is a workhorse. Of course, man from Karnataka, Professor U.R. Rao, and I don't have to tell, we are sitting in a place where, his association with this organization so much. He is the chairman of the governing council of this particular institute or where you are sitting. And he is the man who, I would say, architect of satellites, right from Aryabhata. To start with, he was Aryabhata project director, I joined under him. Okay, so he is right from Aryabhata, the way we have come along today, satellite, one of the leading nations in the world, is because of him. And man who initiated applications aspect. Dr. Kasturi Ranjan is the time, his duration is the time when the things got transformed into applications touching the common man. Several applications, ISRO took the lead. And you name telemedicine, tele-education, you name many things, several things. Remote sensing application. He was the direct project director of our first operational remote sensing satellite, IRIS-1A. And in his time, several things happened. Of course, Dr. Madhavan Nair, he took over later. His time, our launch vehicles, especially he has a great contribution to our PSLV and all launch vehicles. And it is during his time that Chandrayaan was done. And it is his time that several successes are there. And our present leader, Dr. K. Karalakrishna, under his tenure, cryogenic engine successful testing had happened. And then navigation going in a big way. And then Mangalyaan to top it all. And there are several missions which are in the offing. If you go to ISRO Satellite Center, today you will see in the assembly hall, simultaneously 7 to 8 satellites getting assembled. Productionization era just come. And these are all the people who made it possible. That is why I generally put these pictures at the end of every one of my talks.
I basically want to ask about spy satellites. Yeah. So I'll assume that they are actually lower than the IRS also, that is remote sensing satellites also.
Spy satellites are in the lower altitude, and they are short-lived for the simple reason, lower the altitude, atmospheric drag effect is more, the orbit decay is more, so your correction requirements are more, so obviously they are short-lived. They are lower because they generally have to do high-resolution imaging that is there, so generally spy satellites are lower. But today's technology has advanced so much that even at a higher altitude, you are able to do higher-resolution imaging. That's all I can tell about them. What are the benefits of Mangalyaan for a common man or some country? He is asking like that. Okay, this talk, question should not be put to me. But I will tell one thing. Mangalyaan, any interplanetary exploration is done for specific purposes. I can list some 4 or 5 of them. There is a requirement to study about, scientifically, about birth and death of stars, the way in which the planets evolve, the plane will, what will happen to the planets after some time, a planet's atmosphere around the planets. If there is an atmosphere, what will happen to this atmosphere? The action by which how the atmosphere depletes, or what is going to happen to the atmosphere, or this is one part. Then search for natural resources like minerals or any other things beyond Earth. Third thing is any capability or possibility of establishing the human colony elsewhere. Now you may ask why? The question is to talk of a situation where something comes after some time, our human generation, can it grow somewhere else? That is all I can tell. Okay, that's what. So these are these things. Beyond that, this is one aspect. Now, obviously, when you tell this, people will tell all countries together should do it. Unfortunately, my friend, it doesn't happen like that. Okay, so there are several countries which have been doing this experiment. But I will tell the advantages otherwise. Today Mars, the atmosphere in Mars is thin. 90%, more than 90% is carbon dioxide. But that the on Mars, the images taken by Mars Express shows very clearly plenty of water has flown on Mars at one time. Plenty of water. Even in the show, they show that. Where has this water gone? Number one. Well, how is the atmosphere escaping? NASA mission MAVEN today, which has been sent, prime purpose is to study the escape of atmosphere various contents to this thing. The prakriya area, that prakriya now should go back. It has to be understood. Why it has to be understood? Mars may be now. It may happen to us later. So this has to be understood. This is a prime thing, one of the things. Even our Mangalyaan also has carried an equipment which studies the exosphere. Okay, there is. And then, of course, search for life, search for methane. All those things have to be done. This is one part. Second part I will tell you. Today, Mars, Mangalyaan, several technologies which have been done in Mangalyaan, I give some talk in some places about what are the benefits of Mangalyaan in terms of our space technology, our bread and butter satellite. I will tell you one case. There is Mangalyaan who introduced autonomy, spacecraft autonomy. This autonomy is the thing by which it will understand its own difficulties. It will find out if there is anything malfunctioning, correct itself, either switch out the redundant system or switch itself, find out the cause, and then isolate that particular system and proceed further. This is computer-based software system, autonomy. So much of autonomy has been built in Mangalyaan. All these operations I told you, trans-Mars injection, Mars capture, everything was done autonomously. Now this is going to be, as we build this, we adopt this into our satellites. Today, if you take our geostationary satellites, communicating satellites, HASAN, every day for some satellites, they send hundreds of commands per day. They send, they sit 365 days, 24 hours, they have to watch what is happening. By introducing some of these things, there are two satellites for which we send hardly 6-7 commands. We want to come to a stage, we don't have to send any commands. These are all coming only because of this. But autonomy, we will not build in geostationary satellite just like that. It is very costly affair. We build in Mars because it is required. We built. We tested it. Once we tested it, we adopted. Like that, I can tell you, our friend is sitting there. Liquid apogee motor. We have now come to know that liquid apogee motor, we can fire for any number of time, keep it in dormant condition for 300 days and utilize. This has got a big impact. Like this, there are, I can list several technologies which are there in Mangalyaan. Every one of them will flow to INSAT and IRS. Please note. The question is, when we were doing earthbound maneuvers, increasing the orbit size, how did we ensure that we were not affected by either satellites or debris? Generally, debris-related aspect is taken care primarily in the satellite design. Okay, the satellite design of various subsystems, especially structure and various part of the satellite, takes care of certain aspects, solar panel. Even a small, I would say, 2-centimeter object also can come and hit on the solar panel. So the design of all these things takes care to sustain certain level of the objects. The object size keeps on increasing, the population of object is substantially comes down. So if you ask me, the probability of two satellites colliding is almost zero, even though that has happened. But it is like that. That is one aspect. Second aspect is, you are asking about other satellites. So generally, these all the space bodies, I will tell you, all the space bodies up to certain size, I would say up to 6 centimeters or something, are catalogued around Earth, are catalogued, and their orbit is known, made known. It is by a tracking system established by US Defense, and it is an organization called NORAD, through which it is made available. In fact, you might have seen sometime when you launch PSLV, we declare a particular time and we shift it by a second or something. We do that. What we do, we keep on calculating whether there is any possibility of any of these objects hitting the rocket. Because near Earth, more and more objects are there. So we sometimes calculate that even if there is a chance of it going few thousand kilometers nearby our track also, we postpone by 1 second. So that things we do. But coming to satellite, when we do this maneuver, at that portion, and generally it is done by satellite design, okay, by this thing. Otherwise, I am not wrong, I don't think any other thing is done. But I will tell you an interesting thing, now that you have raised this issue. Today, for example, we are going through a phase where in Mars, near Mars, one siding spring, am I right? That is the name of the comet, siding spring. This is the comet which is passing its tail is passing Mars on 19th October. Okay? 19th, the website, NASA website says 19th. Maybe they are 19th, we are 10th. So possible. So 19th October. So some missions are doing this maneuver to see that when it is passing, at that time, the direction in the, with respect to Mars, where it is passing, they are adjusting the orbit in such a way that at that time it will be behind Mars. That is being done by NASA. I don't know, ISRO also may be planning, I am not aware. Okay, anyway, he says, I am last now, January I have retired. So, he says we are doing. So, this is what I am trying to tell is, perhaps what ISRO is doing, the only thing they will do generally is, plane of the orbit will be same, they will change the size of the orbit, change the orbital period. So that the time they will adjust in such a way that when tail passes, because the tail brings lot of particles, lot of meteorites, so it is very harmful for satellites. So they will make it go behind Mars, maybe they will take pictures also, I don't know, possibility is there. At least NASA, Mars Express, Mars Odyssey, Mars Odyssey, Mars Reconnaissance Orbiter and MAVEN, there are three of them orbiting Mars today from NASA. All three of them, two of them they already done, age of the orbit, MAVEN they are doing shortly. So they are doing this. I mean, interestingly telling. Here, we do this during the maneuver, your question was. We never, I don't think we have bothered about the debris and all that. Am I right? While doing the maneuver?
No, we are worried about the debris.
And what did we do?
Tail of the comet.
Yeah, tail of the comet there. He is asking around Earth.
No, we are not.
Yeah, we are not. We are not. Most of the satellites, they don't, because they take in design. Design itself will be such that. Some particles hit, they hit on the solar panel also, many of our satellites, the particles hit. There is a comet called Temple Turtle, which used to visit every time during November, and we used to sometimes change the orientation of the satellite. Solar panel, if it is coming direction, we change it this way, power generation will be reducing. We used to do all that, that is fine. So your question is, during this maneuver we did, we did not bother before. She wants to introduce the ISROites who are here. Total Jacob. He is the deputy director of Mangalyaan, responsible for the design of the LAM and also the propulsion system. We have Krishnan, who is also with Shekhar. He is a person who has provided the software support. There are a lot of software for this. Everyone has got associated software. He is the one who has provided the support for very critical, crucial software for this propulsion system. Both of them are from Liquid Propulsion System Center. Yeah, Venkat Reddy, all LPSC people are here. It is a pride for us, LPSC, Liquid Propulsion System Center. We have one more person, Vishnu, why don't you come here? Just come, but people are not able to see. Vishnu Pai, he is the person who is in our ground checkout group. Ground checkout group is responsible for testing of the satellite once it is ready. Almost all kinds of tests which are being done, testing out the satellite, they do the yeoman service. Every satellite goes through almost 4 or 5 months of thorough testing. In Mangalyaan, it has been a much very, very high level thorough testing. Thank you once again for your patience.
I extend a very warm thanks to Dr. P.J. Bhatt for a wonderful exposition on how the orbits are the ones which are very, very crucial for the simple reason that all the payloads and all the materials that go into making of the satellites and rockets, they are ground tested here. When it comes to orbits, you just have to believe in your physics and mathematics and hope that it works. And so far it has worked. So thank you very much for a wonderful introduction to the physics of orbits. And as a token of appreciation, we present a memento to Dr. P.J. Bhatt. And one word of thanks to the persons who have contributed to this memento. One, Dr. Parthasarathy and Professor Keshav Bulbule. Both of them are not here, so in absentia we thank them. They have made this memento precisely for this particular occasion. It is made out of electronic waste, recycled electronic waste. This is from a unit called E Parisara near Dobbspet. So, as a symbolic gesture, we have a leaf on which gold has been coated. This gold has been completely recovered from used electronic goods, and their message that they want to convey through this is that environment is more precious than gold. So we thank them also. So thank you all once again.